Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know your baby boy, he come to make you new? This child that you delivered would soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would give sight to the blind men? Did you know that your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy walked where angels trod? When you kissed this little baby, you kissed the face of God. Mary, did you know? Oh, Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, and the dead will live again. The lame will leap, and the dumb will speak the praises of the Lamb. Did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? And the sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am. Oh, Mary, did you know? Mary, did you know? Would you pray with me? Bow together with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Mary, that she found favor in your eyes. But we also thank you for Jesus and the baby that you sent to us, your only son, the sacrificial lamb, the Savior of the world. As we celebrate this time of year, may it be a time when we honor your son. We pray today for this service. We thank you for Mike and Annette Racy and years that they've given sharing your gospel on the mission field. We thank you for this church and how it's shared the gospel for all of these many years. I pray that this morning that you will do something in us, that you might do something through us. We pray for those who are listed as physically ill among our people. We could list all their names. Those who are battling the virus, those who are battling other things. But Lord, we lift them to you, and we know that you know what they need. And we pray for you to perform healing. Lord, make us a people after your own heart. I pray that you would help us to seek your face. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're visiting with us today, we say thank you for coming. There is a guest card in front of you, and if you'll just take a minute and fill that out, you can drop it in a plate when you exit. We thank you so much for being here. I do want to introduce, because I'm not going to get up again until the invitation closing announcements, but I'll introduce to you Brother Mike Racy. Mike and Annette are some of our best friends. I really could stand up here and talk a long time about Mike's mom and dad and Annette's mom and dad. But I will say this. Mike's dad and I spent almost an entire year together because when I went to the church in Biloxi, he was chairman of the personnel committee, and we spent a year trying to get staff together. And so Brother Mike and Annette have been missionaries in Chile. I don't even know how many years. I've been saying close to 30. Am I close to right? 27. And when we talked about a mission speaker, I didn't even have to pray about it. I knew who God wanted us to have. So at the appropriate time, Brother Mike, you come and you preach and you speak as the Lord leads you. God bless you. Brother Eric?
Good morning. So good to have you with us. I see some visitors with us today. So good to be in the house of the Lord. Let's stand together. We're going to sing our call to worship, hymn number 182. We'll sing all three. Amen. You can be seated. We're going to continue singing a Christmas song, then we'll watch a video, and then Brother Mike, it'll be all yours after the video, okay? We're going to sing hymn number 204, All Three of All Is Well. Christ is come. Go and tell that he is in the manger. Sing alle, sing alleluia. All is well, all is well. Lift up your voice and sing. Born is now Emmanuel. Born is our Lord and Savior. Sing alleluia. Sing alleluia. All is
like sheep who gone astray. But God so rich in mercy loved us and showed us grace. He gave his only son.
Jesus, hope of the world. Buenos días, hermanos. Les saludo en el nombre del Señor Jesucristo y les traigo saludos de los hermanos bautistas en Chile, Uruguay y Costa Rica. Good morning, brothers and sisters. I bring you greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and I bring you greetings in the name of Baptist brothers and sisters who live in Chile, Uruguay, and Costa Rica. It is a privilege for us to be here today. My wife and I have been looking forward to this, and if I can talk after that video, I'm not sure I can continue talking or not, but it's a wonderful privilege we have to be with you today in this beautiful church. Excuse me. I don't know why I'm a crybaby, but I am. This beautiful church decorated at this beautiful time of the year, and just being here with good friends, we appreciate that. And I appreciate your prayers this morning. Because it's been a while since I've actually done a missions sermon, message, or whatever you want to call it, talk. It's something very close to my heart. Annette and I, we have been away from the mission field for quite a while, but at the same time, it's always been in our hearts. And I thank you as a church for your support of missions around the world. You have a part in this video that we just saw. You have a part in what's going on in every part of this world today. Because of your faithfulness and your giving, your faithfulness in praying, your faithfulness in just supporting the cause of Christ Jesus around the world, you have a part in that, and I appreciate that. Let me say just a few things about us. I'm not going to spend much time on this, but it's always better if you know who's standing before you a little bit before they speak, so you kind of know who they are. You know, Brother Jerry might have just gone downtown and just grabbed me off the street and said, "Hey, would you come speak today?" And you wouldn't know anything about me or my wife, but my wife and I, Annette, we were both brought up in Biloxi, Mississippi. As Jerry talked about, he pastored my home church and a great time there. And my parents and Annette's parents both from that area. And we went to the mission field. I hesitate to use dates because some of you weren't born then, but anyway, I'm going to say it anyway. We went to the mission field in 1984. God called us, and we were appointed in Biloxi, Mississippi at the Coliseum, one of the very few times they did, at that time, an appointment service away from Richmond. And we went with the old, it was called the Foreign Mission Board. Do you remember that? Anybody remember the Foreign Mission Board? Well, we went with the Foreign Mission Board. And we came home on furloughs, and then they changed it to the International Mission Board. We didn't come home on furlough anymore. We came home on stateside assignment, and so they called it that. And so there are a lot of changes that we went through over the years, and we have three boys and a girl, and two of those were born in the States, and two were born overseas, and God has blessed their lives, and they're, of course, adult children now. And we don't hear as much from them as we'd like to, but we also have 5 grandchildren. And so don't know if we're ever going to get any more, but that's okay. We're good with that. We'll take what we got. But God's blessed us a great deal. And that's been busy also since we've been back from the field. We came back actually under some circumstances that you may understand. Annette's parents were not doing well when we returned on a stateside assignment. And we recognized we'd just recently been transferred, and we were going to Spain, going to Europe to serve the Lord there. And Annette's parents were doing very poorly, her father physically, and her mother had some dementia issues and some other things. And we were the only children that they had, and so we had to choose a very difficult decision to stay, difficult in one way, not difficult in another, to minister to them in their last days. And so we did that, and God blessed us for that, and we were able to pastor during that time, and God blessed us in a great way. And Annette's been very busy. She's been on mission trips. She's been working with women's ministry. She's been to Romania and Canada and Nicaragua and Chile and Cuba since we've been back, haven't you? She's been very busy working and keeping me straight, which is kind of a hard thing to do. But anyway, we have been very blessed by God in these last few years. Now, some people have asked me, what was the most difficult thing for you when you returned from mission service? People are always asking that. What's the difference, or how do you feel, or anything like that? And I said, well, one of the most difficult things for me to come back to the States and begin working in a local church here was that we were spending, as I saw it at the time, inordinate amount of times with with saved people, with people that were Christians. As missionaries, we spent about 80% of our time with lost people. Every single day with lost people. And several times a week we had meetings in our home with lost people. And we everything we did revolved around getting the message of Christ to people that did not know Christ Jesus. And so for us to come back and work in a local church and pastor and those kind of things, and I'm not disparaging that. I'm not saying that's a bad thing, Brother Jerry. That's a good thing. Pastors need to be doing that. You need to be working with your church. But to us, that was so different because we were now working so much time with people that knew Christ. And we love brothers and sisters in Christ, but it was just different for us. And that was a difficult thing for us to get used to. There are several other things that we had trouble with, but that I'll let that suffice for now. I want to get right to the text this morning because I can talk and talk and talk and it won't mean anything, but God's Word is what we come here for, is to hear God's Word. Turn with me, please, to Luke chapter 15, and I'll begin reading in verse 1 and read through verse 7. Luke chapter 15, verses 1 through 7, a very familiar passage of Scripture that you know as the lost sheep. Luke 15, 1 through 7. And this is God's Word. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him. And the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. "What man of you having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost.' Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance." May God bless the reading of His Word this morning in our hearing. Her name is Anna. Anna had been invited to attend English classes. Missionaries had decided one way to reach out to the community was to teach English, because a lot of people wanted to learn to speak English, and they had no connection with churches or anything like that, and there was no Christians in their families or friends, circle of friends, and so they offered English classes, and Anna came to that English class, and she attended those classes where they not only taught English as another language, they also shared from their lives. These missionaries shared their testimonies. They shared what Christ had done in their life, how Christ had transformed their lives and given them new life in Christ Jesus. And Anna came to those classes over and over again, and Anna had a lot of questions. I mean, a lot of questions. Every time they did an English class and shared anything spiritual, immediately Anna had questions about it. And she didn't understand things, for example, how a loving God, and she'd heard about this loving God, how this loving God would love her but be concerned about her life, and in the sense that, you know, if she was living with a man and he no longer pleased her, she should be able just to get rid of him and get another guy, you know? Ladies, don't get any ideas. You can't do that, okay? That's not the way it is. But she didn't understand why God would even be concerned with that, because wouldn't God want her to be happy? You see where I'm going? And she had no real background or understanding of God's Word. Not long after that, Anna began visiting the missionary's home every week, bringing her boyfriend. And they talked and they studied and they asked questions hour upon hour, week after week, month after month, and several times during those meetings, one or the other, Anna or her boyfriend, would be at the point of making a profession of faith. The missionaries would be dealing with them and talking with them and leading them, and all of a sudden, you know what would happen? The phone would ring. Somebody would knock on the door. Or they realized something was going on and they were missing it. Or one of them got sick or whatever it was. Over and over and over again, things like that would happen. Things just got in the way, and it looked like nothing was going to happen. After all the time invested, all the meetings, all the Bible studies, all the prayer times, all of the times together, the missionaries said, "You know what? I'm just frustrated. I don't know if anything's ever going to happen. I've invested so much time. Our text today, I could have chosen 1,000 scriptures today because really, you know as I know, the Bible is a missions text, really. Almost everything in the Bible, well, maybe I can't do it the way I'm supposed to, but I can preach missions out of any verse in the Bible. Did you know that? I can pretty much take missions out of any verse. And I could have taken one of thousands of verses probably today for our text today, but I wanted to take this text because of the urgency I see in this text. And I do believe that today we are need to be urgent about sharing the gospel message with the world. I believe we need to be doing that. And the question that I bring to you today, and you may be asking these questions, others ask these questions, is it still valid concern today? Are missions still valid today? Or do we need to be worried about missions today? With all the other things that we've got going on, you know, do we need to worry about missions? One man said years ago, kind of tongue-in-cheek, he said, at Lottie Moon time, he said, are we still paying her off? Hadn't we paid Lottie off yet, you know? We've been paying payments on her for years, and she's still every year, you know. But yet, the question is it something we need to be about? I believe it is. You know, less than 5% of the world's population lives here in the United States. And Jesus told the followers to go to the nations. He told us to go to the nations. Now, he wasn't talking about in that statement, he wasn't talking about the geopolitical divisions that we have today. He wasn't just talking about go to France and Italy and Canada and Cuba or wherever it may be. He was talking about the ethnicities of the world, all the different ethnicities that make up the world that we make up and we call countries today. And I'll share a little bit more about that in a moment, but this passage of Scripture, the urgency is because a sheep had been lost. Well, you know, the Pharisees were grumbling again. I tell you what, the Pharisees, they loved to grumble. They were part of the Grumble Baptist Church, I guess. I don't know. But everything that Jesus did, they grumbled about it. And don't miss this, because they were grumbling. And the reason they were grumbling was because the tax collectors and the sinners were drawn to Jesus. They were sinners, they were tax collectors, they were lost, and yet they were drawn to Jesus because of His words, because of His authority, because of His power, because of His love and acceptance of them, and His belief that they could follow God. The Pharisees, as were many in Jesus' day, were inwardly focused. They thought the only thing important was what was going on in their life. And Jesus was trying to get them to understand that there were others around, not part of their little circle or their little group, that God wanted to minister to, that God wanted to bring to Himself, and that they had a responsibility to do that, to reach out and to teach and to preach and to love and to give. Now, the text does not tell us to leave the 99 alone in danger. Doesn't say that. Sometimes when we read this passage of Scripture, it kind of sounds like you're saying, you know, just abandon the 99 and go after the one. But if you read the text of this Scripture, basically what it's talking about is that the 99 are not abandoned, they are left in the good pasture lands. You see, there's water, there's grass. They are left in the area of where they normally would eat and survive. And so the Scripture is not saying to abandon them, but it's saying we must at some times move our focus one way to the other. For example, when we're talking about ethnicities a moment ago, I was just thinking about, we talk about countries, and we think about countries, we think about Africa, the continent, and we think about countries in Africa, and we think about countries like Nigeria, and we think of Nigeria as one country. Did you know that there are over 540 ethnicities or ethnic groups in Nigeria? 540. They have hundreds of different languages that they speak. And so when we look at a place, or we understand that when we're reaching out to individuals around the world, we're not reaching necessarily the same type people everywhere. There's over 7,400 unreached people groups which basically means there's several ways to define that, an unreached people group. And one of those ways is if there's less than 2% believers or Christians in that group. Now think about that for a moment, 2%. And after 2%, in missions terminology, that's when we're looking to move and go somewhere else. And you say, 2%, that's not very many. No, it's not. It's not. Think about that for a moment, 2%. And some of those groups are groups of the size of 10 million people, and they have less believers than we have in this building this morning. 10 million believers in a people group, and less than this number of believers in that group. Think about that for a moment. You see, we take it for granted, don't we? We take the gospel for granted. We take Bibles for granted. We take churches for granted. You know, if we don't like this church, Brother Jerry, and I'm not saying I'm not advocating this, if we don't like this church, we can go down the road a couple miles and there's another one, you know, and probably several in that area. These people groups that I'm talking about comprise about 40% of the world population, which is fastly going past 7 billion people, or it is past 7 billion people now. So when you think about that, put that in perspective of how many people in the world do not know Christ as Lord and Savior. Now, that's not to say we don't have need here. We have need here in the United States, don't we? We have lost people right here, all around us, in Foxworth, in Columbia, in Hattiesburg, in Laurel, where we live, on the Gulf Coast. We have lostness. We have people that don't know Christ all around us. But you know, at the same time, we're the most churched nation in all the world. We have churches there. I thought I had seen a lot of churches. I'll just be honest with you. I thought I'd seen a lot of churches till we moved to Laurel, Mississippi. I mean, we've got... Honey, isn't that true? Am I lying? If Jerry Clower said, if I'm lying, I'm dying. You know, we have churches everywhere, on every street corner, and you can choose the flavor you want. We've got all kind of flavors of churches everywhere. They're everywhere, and we sometimes get tickled because there are so many churches. Now, I don't know how many people are going to those churches, and I don't know how many lost people live next door, but we have a lot of churches. And unfortunately, a lot of times today, planting churches, and I'm afraid sometimes what's happening is we're simply moving sheep from one pen to the other. You know, we're moving sheep around, and it looks like we're doing a lot of church planting, but we may just be moving people, the same people around. I don't know if that's true. But around the world, churches may look differently than here. I hope you've been on a mission trip. If you hadn't, I pray that you will in the future. I hope that you will. Churches look differently. They may not look as beautiful as this. This is a beautiful church, by the way. Somebody did a wonderful job decorating this church. I'll just tell you, they did a wonderful job. And it may not look like this. It may look a whole lot like your living room. Did you know it? It may look like your basement or your garage or your place of business, because we've met in all those places in churches. And churches are going to look differently around the world, but the one thing that is true is the gospel of Jesus Christ is being proclaimed around the world. In our parable this morning of the lost sheep, not only was there a lost sheep, but then the shepherd, it talks about leaving and seeking and searching and looking for. And you know, we can't expect to reach the world without that. That's going to take some sacrifice. It's going to take some going. It's going to take some planning, and it's going to take a lot of different things. Some people say, well, let's just send money and let them take care of it. You know, they've got some churches that can do that. Let's just send the money. The problem is, there's not enough to do the job. And by the way, we have the Great Commission. We are called to go. As Baptists, unfortunately, a lot of times we like to stay, but we're called to go. Did you know it? We're called to go. We're called to go forth and preach and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ to the nations. Some say just some money and let them do it. And some say, well, all we have to do is send shoeboxes. And don't get me wrong, I love shoeboxes. I'll just tell you. Annette and I have worked on both ends of that. We have packed shoeboxes. We have been to the packing center in Atlanta. We have worked long hours on that assembly line till I thought I couldn't stand up anymore. And we have been on the other end. We've been on the mission field where those boxes came in a container, and they took those boxes out and they shared those with children. And those children opened those boxes, and maybe for the very first time they realized somebody in the world knew they were even alive. And if somebody cared enough to pack one of those boxes, not only with little goodies and treats, but also it came along with a little booklet that talked about this man named Jesus. And they went to classes every single week for weeks. They went to classes to hear about this man Jesus, and many of them have made professions of faith. So don't get me wrong, I'm not downplaying shoeboxes, okay? I'm not downplaying anything that gets the gospel where it needs to be. I'm not against anything that gets the Bible into people's hands where it needs to be. My chairman of the deacons and treasurer and other things at the last church I was at was a big Gideon speaker, and a big part of Gideon's, and he went all over the world with Gideon's International. And I tell you, I just said, God bless you, man. If you can get God's word in anybody's hands, let's do it. You see, we must give, but we must also be willing to go. We give to the cooperative program, and I love the cooperative program. We give to Lottie, and we give to Annie, and it's all needed. We need to be doing that. We need to be about that. But it's going to take more than that. It's going to take more resources. It's going to take more personnel. It's going to take prayer. It's going to take a lot of different things to reach the world for Christ today. Let me share just a brief story with you. Annette and I were working in the Patagonia of Chile, right on the Straits of Magellan. For any of you know, it's about 7,500 miles south. East of here, long way southeast. It's more east than south, believe it or not. Right on the Straits of Magellan, and we were working in a small community named Villa Tehuelches. And Villa Tehuelches is a little, basically it's a sheep station, and more sheep than people in that area. And there was a school there, and it was a boarding school. And what it was all the sheep stations of the area would send their children when they got old enough. And when I say old enough, I mean if they were old enough to stand up and carry a book bag, they were old enough to go. And they put them on a bus, and they arrived at that little school and got off that bus. And you've never seen little bitty kids this tall with little book bags getting off that bus, and they're going to that boarding school, and they're staying there all week. And then at the end of the week, they get their little book bags, they get back on the bus. And we began noticing, we'd done a mission project in that little town one time. I say little town, it was a very little town. And we stopped there one time, and there was a nice school, the boarding school there, and we talked to the people there, and they were very nice, and they asked us what we did, and we said, well, we're missionaries, and we're sharing the gospel message, and we'd just like to maybe come sometime and just share with your children if we could. They said, great, how about next week? Okay, so we came back a week or two later, and we shared with the children, and they said, well, why don't you come back the next week? We said, okay. And before it was over, we were actually the Christian education department of that school. Our three missionary team, it was Annette and myself, and missionary Jackie Bursmeyer, who is now a retired single missionary, retired in St. Louis. And we got in our truck every single week, and we went to Villa Tehuelches, and we ministered to those children. We did chapel time with them. We did crafts with them. We brought in a volunteer team once or twice with them to work with that school. And we had children come to know Christ through that, and we had teachers come to know Christ through that. And the interesting thing about it was, as we were getting together one day, the principal of the school said, the other schools around here are jealous. They said, why? I said, well, because they've heard that we have our own missionary team that comes and does Christian education at our school, and they want you to come to their school too. I wish we could have. There was three of us. We had all kind of projects and things going on, but there were schools, there were rural schools in that area, exactly like Villa Tehuelches. And the principals were saying, would you send somebody? Would you just send somebody to do Christian education? We'd love to have you. You're welcome. You can do anything you want. You can have programs with our kids. You can do crafts. You can do whatever you want with our children. They need this. Now, I don't know about you, but when a missionary has to say, we can't because of personnel issues, we just don't have the people to do it, it hurts. to this day, it hurts. We could have gone to every isolated school in that region. And I believe God wants us to go. I believe the door is open. It's there. It's probably still there. It's still open. And the Great Commission that we speak of, my friends, today, the Great Commission is to the church. It's to you and me, by the way. You are the church. You know that. Brother Jerry's a good enough Bible expositor to tell you that. You're the church. You know, it's not the brick and mortar. It's not the windows. It's not the instruments. You are the church. And the Great Commission is given to you. The Great Commission is given to me. It's not given to the IMB or to NAM or to Samaritan's Purse or the Mississippi Baptist Convention or even the Southern Baptist Convention. All of those entities are good, and all of those entities work together to bring the gospel of Christ to people who need to hear. But that commission is to the church. It's to you and me. So we can never get comfortable and say, well, you know, I'll give a little bit in the offering plate, and everything's okay. Because that commission is to us. We cannot turn our backs on it. We cannot say, you know, I can't physically go, and so it's not for me. We can't say that. The commission is to us. We all must work in cooperation. And it's not over just because we support these ministries all the time. But it doesn't relieve us of the responsibility to go across the street either. It doesn't relieve us of the responsibility to go to our own families and share Christ with those in need. And that's hard. I'll tell you that. I know that's hard. We have a responsibility to share the gospel here where we are and around the world. You see, that's what the commission is all about, and that's what the lost sheep parable is all about. As a young Christian, I became a Christian as a teenager. I was about 15 years old, if my recollection is correct. And from the very beginning, you know how people struggle with this thing about, should I go and be a missionary? You know, have you ever struggled with that? You know, does God want me for a missionary? You know what I had to struggle with? Does God want me to actually stay here? I'm just saying that's the way, I don't know why, but from the very beginning, that's what God put in my heart, that you need to go. And I'm thinking, oh, do I need to stay? Do I need to stay? I've got to go. There's a compulsion in my life. I have to go. I have to be part of world evangelism in some way. We must be willing to go. The parable, by the way, is not for the sheep, the lost sheep. Leave them alone and he'll come home wagging his tail behind him. No, that's not what the parable says, is it? We have to go. We have to be willing to go. The parable talks about not only the shepherd going and seeking, but he to locate, to find, and to share. And it shows this man actively searching and seeking. And you see, that's the beauty of Lottie Moon and the cooperative program. You know, some of us can't go around the world. I recognize that. So don't get guilty about, I can't go. I'm physically can't go. Don't feel guilty about that. Okay? We can't all do that. But you know what? As I told you before, you have a part in it. You can send people around the world. You can have a part in that. When Anna or anybody else is being ministered to, you have a part in that. You have a part in that. You have a place there. You're holding the ropes, as one missionary once said. You see, that's the beauty of the cooperative program in Lottie Moon. Some of these missionaries that you know and you've heard of are serving in closed countries. Countries where they're not allowed to say, I'm a missionary. Countries where they can't really come out and preach on the streets or anything like that. They would be arrested if they did. And so a lot of those are what we call platform missionaries. And these platform missionaries do everything from teaching English in a university. They have the credentials. They go and they teach. Or maybe we had knowledge of some that actually opened a coffee shop, kind of a Starbucks kind of a thing, you know. Everybody likes coffee, and so they opened a little Starbucks-type coffee. It wasn't Starbucks, by the way, but it was just their own brand of coffee. I opened a little coffee shop, and people would come, and while they were there, they had an opportunity to speak to them. And they would minister to them as they drank coffee. And they'd say, "Oh, by the way, we've got this little study going on. And if you'd like, you can come." And people would come to the Bible study. So you see, missionaries do all kinds of things all over the world, in areas of the world that you may not even understand or that they're working. But all of the missionaries that I know, all are sacrificing, all are risking their lives for Christ, and everyone that I know would be willing to die for Christ. Of course, we don't know that till the moment comes, but I think they would. Annette and I, our last assignment, which I shared with you, we didn't know it was our last assignment. We were actually sent to Costa Rica, where we had been before, to serve as mentors for new missionaries that were just being appointed and leaving the United States and going to Latin America, all through Central America, South America, all of the countries that speak Spanish. And we had the privilege of being mentors. And so what we did was, it was kind of like a coaching thing, you know. We had a group of missionaries, and I would work with them and share with them experiences, and we would share with them how to stay on the field and how not to get frustrated, and encourage them in language study, because there are going to be days that you're not going to believe you'll ever be able to speak the language, and on and on and on it goes, you know. And I want to just commend that group of young people we worked with. I say young people, some of them were older than we were, but they were wonderful individuals. You would be so proud to see the quality of personnel that are being sent in God's name and in your name, New Hope Baptist Church. People around the world are being sent, and they are quality individuals. They are individuals that want to see Christ proclaimed. They are willing to sacrifice. They're willing to give up jobs and give up careers and all kinds of things to go and share the message of Christ. They're willing to drag those kids with them wherever they go, plug those kids in schools wherever they are. They're willing to pick them up and go. You would be so, so proud of those individuals as they go. This man finds this sheep and lays it on his shoulder. And you know what? There's great rejoicing. The church should be the most joyful place in all the world. I think it would be. And I think some of you can't see it because you got your mask on. But anyway, I think some of you are smiling right now. I think there's joy knowing that Christ is being proclaimed around the world. And as Baptists, as Christians, we need to be known not for what we don't do necessarily, but we need to be known for what we do. And how we love and how we share. And I'm smart enough as a missionary to know that I don't save anybody. Did you know it? All I can do is share the gospel of Christ Jesus. I give the invitation. And guess what? The Spirit of God deals in the hearts of individuals. And He draws. He's the Lord of the harvest. I'm not even the John Deere. You know, I'm not even that exactly. I'm just the guy that kind of runs along behind a tractor, you know. And God does that. But what rejoicing there is. Rejoicing to see people come to Christ. Rejoicing to see them take their first steps in Christ as they mature. They become leaders. They make disciples of others. But you know what? You know what's frustrating? Sometimes we don't get to see the end result. That's very true in mission service. We moved around a lot. We were in three different countries and spent almost 27 years on the field. And we ministered to I don't know how many people. Over the years. I don't know how many Bible studies. I don't know how many preaching times. I don't know how many times on the street we spoke to people. I don't know how many Bibles we handed out. I don't know how many volunteer teams we were involved in. I don't know. And it was frustrating. And it is frustrating because we don't always get to see the end result. But you remember Anna? I was telling you about a few moments ago. She began to come to Bible studies too. And she came to worship times where we were worshiping, and she came to activities that the women were doing and got involved in that. And not long after that, Annette and I moved to another field. And not long after that, we heard that Anna had made a profession of faith, was baptized, and we rejoiced. We weren't there to see it, but we rejoiced. But you know, the great thing was that the last communication we heard from Anna was that she not only had been saved and baptized, after some time had passed, she was then a leader in the local church. A leader in the local church. Now, I don't know about you, But it makes this Baptist missionary want to jump around a little bit. I know we're not supposed to dance, okay? I understand that. But it gets me excited, and it causes me to rejoice to know what God has done. Even if we don't see the end, we know God is working. God is working in their lives. So what can you do as a church? Now, you've heard this so many times, you could repeat it to me, okay? But I'm going to tell you. First of all, I want you to pray confidently. Not defeatedly. Pray confidently, because the Lord of the harvest is sending out people into the fields, and we have people every single day who are saying, I want to go. I want to be a part of this worldwide evangelistic movement. I want to see people come to Christ. So pray confidently that God would continue to send out workers into his field. Give sacrificially. I know it doesn't seem like it sometimes, but truly we do live in the wealthiest country in the world. We have more than many people in the world could ever dream of having. And I could tell you some things, but I found out over the years that when I do that, it makes people feel guilty, and I don't want you to feel guilty. Because you don't feel guilty because God blessed you and you were born into where you were born and that kind of thing. You don't feel guilty about that. All you can do about that is say, thank God, and I'm going to do what I can to help others. You see what I'm saying? So don't feel guilty about that. We also need to lead our churches to go. Lead our churches to go. Lead our people to go, to step up and say, you know what? I want to go on that trip. I want to be a volunteer. Or you know what? I feel God leading me to missions. What do I do about that? Could God really call me to missions? I'm just a young man. I'm a teenager. I'm a young girl. I'm in school. Could God actually use me? And I can say, yes, he can use you. You say, well, I'm middle-aged. God can't use me, can he? Yes, he can. Yes, he can. You know, some of the greatest missionaries I've ever seen in my life were second career missionaries, that after they had finished a career here in the United States, they came to the field and they plugged in, and God used them in miraculous ways that you would never, ever believe. You say, well, I'm a little past middle age. I don't think God could use me. I don't have time to tell you about the 90-year-old man that came on a volunteer team with us one time. We took one day of sightseeing, and we do that with our volunteers, or try to sometimes, at least give them a little, you know, see where they are, not just keep their nose to the grindstone all the time. And we decided to go up to the mountains and drive up to a ski lodge, you know, just so they could see the snow on the volcanoes and the beauty of the area. And we got up about halfway on the mountain, and this gentleman began to tell us about his condition. He had a heart condition. I said, really? You got a heart condition? He said, yeah, I got a bad heart. He said, matter of fact, I've had surgeries, and I got a pacemaker, and I got all this. And doctor told me I wasn't supposed to get very high in altitude. And so we found out a little bit about it and said, well, how high did your doctor say you weren't supposed to go? He said, well, I don't remember the exact. It was like, you know, I'm not really supposed to go over 4,000 feet, you know, above sea level. We were at 7,000 or so at that time, 7,500. Boy, you talk about a praying missionary, I'll just tell you. We prayed all the way down that mountain again. But don't ever say, God can't use me. You see, God can use you, and he wants to use you. The challenge is to all of us to lead our churches to go, to lead our people to go. And some people are more Timothys who stay in the church, and some are more Pauls who go out on the field. And then finally, my friends, we need to educate. This is so important. Educate this generation of young people. I grew up, I'll admit it, I'm old. Okay, I'll admit it. I grew up, my mother was WMU director. I went to, what they call them, circle meetings or something. I don't remember. When I was this tall, I went to circle meetings with my mother. She put me in a chair. She'd teach the studies for those women, and I'd sit over there quietly. If I didn't, I knew what happened. But anyway, I went through all that. Grew up in that home, grew up in a church that we had RAs and we had GAs, and we learned about missions and we learned about missionaries, and we wrote letters to missionaries, and every once in a while we'd get a letter back, and I tell you what, that was the greatest thing ever. We've got to continue to teach this generation, my friends. We've got to continue to teach the next generation what missions is all about. But it takes time, and it takes a plan to do that. So do that. Let's teach the next generation. Let's educate our next generation in missions. My friends, today, I realize this. I've been all over the map today, literally. But if there's anything from this story I want you to hold with you this morning is this. If you're here this morning, and I don't care if you've been around this community all your life or you're new here or whatever, that doesn't bother me. What bothers me this morning is, do you know Christ Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Have you ever placed your faith and trust in Him and only Him for salvation? Not basing it on your works or your church attendance or Sunday school or anything else. Do you say and know that I am a Christian not because of what I've done, but because of what Jesus has done? And I have received that. I have trusted in Him and Him alone. If you're here this morning and you can't say that, I pray today that before you leave, you could take Brother Jerry's hand. And you say, Brother Jerry, I need to come to Christ today. I need to come to Christ today. That's the first thing. The second thing is this. Maybe you're here today and you've heard these words and you say, well, I knew most everything he said, but God's dealing with me about missions in some way. Maybe it's I need to pray more for missions. Maybe it's I need to be more supportive of missions and missionaries. I need to get busy writing some letters, or I need to be encouraging my church, or I need to get involved in whatever it may be in the church that supports missions. And maybe I need to just become a better giver, you know? Maybe I just need to be a better giver financially for missions in this church. Or maybe you can say, you know what, I need to find out how to go. God's dealing with me, and I can look around here, and I tell you what, anybody that knew me as a young boy would have looked at me and said, that kid will never amount to anything. I'm not saying I did, but I'll just say this. They would have never thought this kid could have ever ended up on the mission field. But you know, it's not about who you are. It's about who he is. And maybe God's calling you out today. Maybe it's a child, a teenager, a young person, middle-aged, an older adult. Whatever God's dealing with you about this morning, all I ask is that you open your heart to the Lord today, whatever that is. We're going to have an invitation time. I'm going to ask Brother Jerry to come here and stand to the front. And I'm assuming we're going to stand and we're going to sing. And so we're going to do that at this time. I just ask you to stand. And if God's dealing with you at this time, I just ask you to step out. Come forward, take Brother Jerry's hand, and let him pray with you and let him speak with you about whatever it is God has for you today. Would you do that? God bless you, my friends. Brother Jerry.
Come just as you are. Hear the Spirit call. Come just as you are.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for the message that we've heard today. We thank you that in giving us your message, that we can respond. And when we respond, you speak to our hearts. And not only do you speak to our hearts, you come into our lives and speak to us. Heavenly Father, I pray that today, I pray if there's someone in this building that's never trusted you as their Lord and Savior, they don't know where they'll go if they were to pass from this life today, I pray that you will speak to them and draw them to yourselves even before they leave this property. I pray for those of us who know you, and I pray, Lord, if our hearts have grown cold, I pray that you will speak to our hearts. But, Lord, as we move forward, as we help do our part with Lottie Moon, I pray that we will do it faithfully. But, Lord, as we get opportunity to go to the mission field, I pray that we will go, that we can be the one that puts that lost lamb on our shoulders and brings them home. Thank you for your love, Lord. I thank you for this day and for the message that Brother Mike's given. I thank you for the friendship with he and Annette over these years. And I pray, Lord, that heaven gets sweeter all the time because we love each other more and more like you've called us to. In Jesus' name, amen.